You found a place to belong here in the Circle of Friends. I'm Missy and I'm with Gwen. And Gwen, we've opened up kind of a hard topic, but a good topic this week, and that of dealing with grief, whether that's your own or others. And I can say from being on both sides of the situation, it's humorous to me now, but one of my good friends as a young married woman, we met in the hospital, and we met over the fact that I told her she was struggling with what people were saying to her as her husband was in the hospital. Mm. She had a child with cancer. I mean, you know, and I said to her, and my husband was in the hospital with appendicitis, and we just lost our first son a couple months. So we were both very, very tender. And I remember saying to her, both in Bible, our husbands were in Bible school, so we knew all the right things to say.
Yeah.
But I said to her, if one more person quotes Romans 8:28 to me, I'm going to blow my head off.
And that verse being, all things work together for good. Oh, that's one of the worst.
And it's an absolute true. It's not that I didn't believe the verse at all. That was not the point or now.
It's just. When you're hurting, it's so callous.
It did not help anything. And so, of course, we laughed because we were both feeling the same way. But it was a good lesson for me in knowing that sometimes words can hurt. Even well-meaning, even true words.
Intended for comfort.
Yeah. Intended for comfort, intended for good.
Yeah.
You know, you'll have another baby or they're in a better place. Or, I mean, you could think of a thousand things people have said out of desiring to say something comforting, and it's not. So, again, we said this yesterday, and I want to say it again. The grieving process is unique to the individual.
Yeah.
How they process it, what they're going through, even if it's similar to something you've been through or you've seen someone else go through, this is their journey.
Yeah.
And it is a privilege to walk alongside someone on their journey.
But they've invited you in.
Right, exactly. Yeah. But we can't go barreling into their life.
No. And we can't force grief, because you've grieved, does not give you a position to go barging into their grief.
Now, I'm going to come at it from another viewpoint, too. To ignore this is also as bad as saying the wrong thing.
Truth.
I mentioned that we lost our first son. I was in Sunday school class, big as a barrel, pregnant 1 week, and no baby the next week. And no one seemed to notice that I didn't have a baby, that I wasn't carrying a diaper bag, that, do you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And those who knew, there were people that knew that we'd lost the baby. They
were scared to talk
about
it.
They turned around and walked away. Like they avoided me like I had the plague. And I understood. I mean, I understood why, how difficult that is. But let me tell you a story about two young men. I mean, we were young. I mean, we were in our early 20s, and a couple of guys, I mean, they were as young as we were. They were fresh into college. It was a Bible college. I mean, and they worked with my husband, and they came to visit me. These are my two visitors. They came in suits and ties, bless their sweet little hearts, and they sat in my living room, and they, like, it was so awkward for them. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Like, what could they say to a lady who lost a child? Mm-hmm. They weren't even dating at the time. You know, it wasn't like they had a girlfriend. Yeah. It wasn't like they'd gone through that. But they knew that they needed to come. And they brought
present.
Me some little gift. And they just, I remember meeting their mom years later after one of them got married. We were at the wedding. And I remember having the chance to tell her, you raised the best boys. And when I described that to her, she kind of got tears in her eyes. I said, that meant so much to me because everybody else was
avoiding it,
turning away from me. You know what I mean? And I'm not being harsh on them. I'm just saying they didn't know what to do. So, okay, I can't handle that situation. So busting is wrong and ignoring is wrong. What are we left with? That's a little bit difficult, right?
Exactly. And you know, there is, and this is where I think you have to walk in with open eyes and listening ears.
Yes.
Because I think if you walk in with your mouth zipped, but you present and you present yourself, but you listen and you hear and you watch, and then when you think you see some things that might be helpful, you ask the Lord first. And if he says, shush, then you keep your mouth shut. And if he says, try it, then you ask for permission before you step further. And I think if you tentatively step closer that way, I think you end up showing more reverence for their process and their grief. Mm. People know when you're paying attention, listening, and when you're not trying to force something, but when you're just attentive and you are asking respectfully to join or to bless or, mm-hmm. you know, to support, they feel that respect. And they can feel when there's an agenda.
And there's a difference, too, in your relationship, with what your relationship is with the person who's grieving. Yeah. And of course you take that into account. Yeah. So
if you're not close to that right. person, you are not going to be one of the people that just walks in and walks them through this journey. That's not going to happen. Even if your grief looks exactly like theirs. Like if you don't have the previous relationship that would give you natural permission, you're probably not going to be the best person to rush in.
Well, and I want to throw this out there, too, for our listeners, because sometimes, okay, there's a grieving process, and specifically I'm talking now about the loss of a loved one.
Yeah.
At the time of the loss, there's probably a lot of attention given.
But the further, flooding.
Yes. Yeah. The further into the grief process you get, the more isolated,
the more other people forget.
They forget.
Yeah.
They
kind of, year two
they kind of, yes.
is a great year to be sending cards.
Yes. Yes. Or yeah, offering mm-hmm. prayer or mm-hmm. just continuing to pray and say, Lord, if you open the door, I'm willing to share or be there mm-hmm. or do whatever. And by that time, sometimes people are looking for someone else. Like, how yeah. did you do that? You know, there's enough yep. time passed that they're looking for the kind of comfort and advice that right. sometimes people want to give. So the opportunity may not be right at the moment,
right.
but continue to pray for them and be with them in that yes. sense for through the journey, through the long haul of the yeah. journey.
And what I would tell you, rule of thumb, is think like a constellation system, like rings orbiting, okay? And if you know that you are one of the two or three people closest to this person, your phone call to them should be, do you need me? Do I need to come? And then you use your gut. Even if they say no,
right.
but your gut says you need to be there, then you go, if you are one of their top three people. And by that, I mean the three people that would know the most about them in their life. If you know you are in that top, that circle, you are their primary support. And so you know that you probably need to be present. Maybe your mouth needs to be shut, but maybe you need to be there. And maybe you need to run interference for everybody coming at them. But I would say that level of closeness, you need to be present. If you don't, your absence is really going to be felt. Mm. And then I would say, you know, if you're not in that circle, then ask yourself how close you are, because that should determine how you approach this. If you know you are in one of the outer rings of Saturn, then you know that you should not be one of the first responders. You know, that you probably, your first response probably needs to be something a little bit safer, like a card, you know, where you just, hey, I see it. I'm praying. If you need anything, I'm here. I would love to support in any way I can. Mm. You know, that's a very safe, thing. And then you keep your ears open. And if there's needs, if there's, you know, for example, if there were hospital bills or there was something like that, that can be somewhere where you jump in to support and to help and to love on them. But you kind of keep your ears open in that process. What do you think, Missy, of what I've kind of said so far?
Yeah, I totally agree with what you just yeah. said. I mean, and I love that you've kind of put it in terms for us to kind of, because sometimes we feel there's expectations on right. us to do something.
Right.
And this kind of frees us up to know that, first of all, pray.
Right.
And God's going to guide us. And then we'll know by circumstance, yeah. by person, by all of those things. And that rushing into something is right. is not at all what we need to do. Right. So there is time to pray. There is time to seek the Lord. There is time to ask him, what is it that I need to do to offer comfort?
Yeah. And, you know, I'll give you an example, Missy. There's been a situation recently where I probably wasn't one of the major three, but I know that I'm a good support. And I know that I might be needed. I mean, as a counselor, as a friend, you know, just with the knowledge and the background that I have. Okay. So I didn't rush in. I sent a couple texts with a very clear do not respond because I'm sure you're getting tons. Mm-hmm. But just know that I love you. I'm praying for you. You are not alone. You know, and just give you, you know, and then just give yourself space to let this be what it is. Mm. And that was it, you know, and then I would, you know, and I just endeavored that I was like, you know what, I'm going to just do this once a week. I don't know how it's landing, but yeah. Once a week isn't too much.
Just a reminder, hey, yeah. I'm praying. And you
but
know
it's
what?
It's just a something.
I find that too, especially in our church, which is mm-hmm. a large gathering. And there are people that I'm not super close to, but there have been mm-hmm. people that have gone through really hard things. And there's always someone going through some kind of difficulty.
Yeah.
And to be able to just, you know, reach out and to smile and say, I'm praying for you. I mean, and I yeah. rarely say more than that.
Yeah.
You know, a hug if I know them well enough to hug them, mm-hmm. A hand on their arm just to know that, you know, I see you, mm-hmm. I know you're suffering, and I'm praying. And that's enough. Or like you said, a simple text that said, I don't expect a response. I just want you to know I'm praying for you.
Yeah.
Scripture is great if it's a comforting scripture. Be careful not to bash anybody with it.
Yeah.
You know, the whole Romans 8:28 we talked about yesterday. Yeah. That's a wonderful verse. And the Bible is true, but it's not to be used as a sledgehammer. Think about what it says. It's sharper than any two-edged sword. It takes very precise precise surgeon yes. to do that. So if it's something that says the Lord is near to the brokenhearted, that is, mm-hmm. that's a wonderful reminder. Or something, I mean, maybe there is a scripture.
A comfort,
something yes. that's comforting.
Not necessarily a truth that's a hard truth.
Yes.
A comfort verse is a good one.
Because, like, yes, that's, yeah. I love that you bring this up because that's exactly what's going to happen. What we need at first is comfort.
Right.
The hard truth that we need to get to will come.
Yes.
But we've got to bind up the wounds first.
Exactly. And you may not be the person that they're going to talk through that truth stuff with.
Yeah.
Because that has to be a safe person. You know what? Let's take a break. And when we come back, let's talk a little bit more about how to move towards somebody in the grief process.
Okay, sounds great.
You found a place to belong here with the Circle of Friends.
Want in on a little secret? The boutique at Village Gift Barn is a big city boutique in the heart of Amish country. Surprised? Most people are. Our beautifully diverse women's boutique carries regular and plus sizes and has something for every woman, no matter what her personal style. We carry everything from unique pieces you won't find anywhere else to the brands you know and love, like Brighton, Pandora, and Vera Bradley. Stop by and let our friendly, knowledgeable ladies help you create a look that's all your own. Village Gift Barn is located in the heart of Amish country at 4755 State Route 39 in Berlin, Ohio.
John Piper once wrote, "The ultimate reason why we are sexual is to make God more deeply knowable." Do you believe that? Do you even know what it means to connect your spirituality with your sexuality? I'm Dr. Julie Slattery from Authentic Intimacy, and I'm coming to the Amish Country Theater in Berlin, Ohio for an all-day women's conference on February 22nd. We'll spend the day talking about God's design for sexuality. So whether you're single or married, 18 or 80, head to AuthenticIntimacy.com/event for your ticket.
days are hastening on, and promises grow old. But with the ever-circling years shall come the wondrous times that were foretold.
We're back here in the Circle of Friends. You're with Gwen and Missy, and we've been talking about grief and going through the grieving process ourselves and with others and how to comfort them. And Gwen, I just want to go back to the verse that we mentioned earlier and read it. It is found in 2 Corinthians chapter 1. I'm going to read from verse 3. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercies and God of all comfort, who comforts us in all our tribulation, that we may be able to comfort those who are in any trouble with the comfort with which we ourselves are comforted by God. That's the model. Mm-hmm. That's the way it's laid out. That's how we should approach others who are grieving.
I love that, Missy.
Yeah, it's all about comfort, right? It's all about offering. I mean, we need to offer truth, love, all grace, all that stuff, but this is comfort, and comfort looks very different from advice or, hey, this is what happened to me, or that's the focus on the other person, which, as we've already stated a couple of times, is in a unique process of grief.
Individual to them.
Individual to them, yes. And maybe somewhat like someone else's, but could be totally different from everybody else.
Yes, and if you walk in thinking theirs is like yours, you're probably going to make some mistakes. Yeah.
I have had people who have tried to compare pain, whether theirs or someone else's, with my pain, mm-hmm. and I always felt it was sort of like, I've had this thought, which is, I'm confessing here on radio. What about if I just take a hammer and slam your hand with it and I tell you how much it hurts? Okay? Mm-hmm. How about that? Why don't we just do that? Mm-hmm. You can't tell someone else what their pain is like.
Right. And you're talking about what it feels like to have somebody come at you and go, oh, I so understand when this happened. I felt devastated. And it was.
Yeah. And yeah, whatever it is that happened. Is
what's really, happening in yeah. that moment is that they are mapping their yes. experience on you.
Yeah.
They're saying, I know exactly what you're going through. I don't even need to listen because I've been here and I know exactly what this looks like.
Yes.
That horrible, horrible. Ouch. Stop. Close your mouth. Back up. Go out the door.
You're whipping them with thorns and not cat of nine tails. Yes. You really are. That's not comfort. It may be comforting you, but it's not comforting.
I'm going to even say that without realizing it, it's more about you yes. than it's about them.
Yes, yes.
Because you're wanting to share your story mm-hmm. more than you're wanting mm-hmm. to comfort them and hear them.
Yeah, exactly.
And so, you know, if that's the motivation of your heart is you want to share your story, be very careful because people can feel that agenda. And when you're grieving, sometimes you're too nice. And you don't say, stop, I can't hear this right now. Or it's too soon for us to talk about how our stories are the same. Or, you know, it's too soon.
Well, they don't have the energy.
They don't have the ability. You know, and we've kind of been told we need to be nice. And so sometimes we'll tolerate somebody else saying it because we don't want to hurt their feelings. Or, you know, they've been through a rough time. And so we're almost comforting them when we're the ones grieving. Mm-hmm. Okay. So, you know, as the person reaching out to somebody grieving, you don't want them comforting you. Because you've shared your story. You don't want them worrying about your feelings. You know, it needs to stay about them. This is tricky stuff.
It is tricky stuff.
Yeah, because we don't always realize that we come at something with an agenda.
Yeah.
But, you know, ask yourself, if they cut me off and say, I can't do this right now, am I going to feel like I know I need to tell you the rest? Because if I feel like I need to tell it, then it's about me. It's not about them.
Well, and I do think, just as we've talked about some of these things, the big thing is caution and yeah. prayer, and do everything covered in prayer, and yeah. approach that is soft and gentle and comforting, covered with prayer before you ever say or do anything, with yeah. the purpose of listening.
Without assumptions.
Without assumption. Yeah.
And being willing to yeah. edit mm-hmm. what you were coming in to do if you see that it's not the time. Yeah. I think that's the biggest thing, like coming at things and going, you know what, I just don't feel right about what I was going to do, so I won't. You know, like I had a friend who lost a little one, and I just really felt like maybe I needed to get them a card that they had lost it mid-pregnancy. And I just kind of felt like I needed to get them a congratulations on your child card, because that's not one we usually get. And I held off because I was like, oh, that could come across really, I'm not so sure, you know. And then I heard them talking about it, and they were talking about how they're proud that they had a son. And that they didn't want to hide it, and they didn't want to, you know, they wanted to be proud that they were parents of him. And I thought, you know what? That card might be okay.
Might be what
if
they needed
to hear. If I found the right one, and on the inside I went, I just wanted to congratulate you. And I'm so sorry you didn't get to hold him longer. You know, and so I'm like, that was kind of where I ended up with that card. And I don't know how it landed. I hope and I prayed over it that it would land at just, you know, the sweet spot that they needed. But I would never do that for another situation.
Right.
Does that make sense?
Absolutely.
For some reason, that felt like the right thing at the right moment for that situation.
Because every grief journey
is
unique.
Different.
It's different in how people respond and what they need. And
exactly.
And where they're at that day.
Right.
It's just, we just have to be very cognizant of the fact that this is their journey. And if it's a privilege, again, to walk beside somebody, but you can't bust into their journey. And I think sometimes we do it with the best of intentions. But again, praying before you speak, and especially if it's not somebody that you're close to, I think we have these expectations that this is how we act, this is what we do, this is what we should do. How about standing back and saying, God, this person is grieving, and I'm asking you to show me and give me eyes to see.
Absolutely.
How can I best love and comfort and support them?
Yeah. And, you know, if you have walked through it, don't disregard your entire experience, you know, but ask.
Yeah.
You know, if you have the permission to kind of do so, if you're close enough in relationship, you can sit there and go, you know, when I was going through this at this point, I wasn't ready for a lot of outside people. How are you doing with that? You know, that's okay, this was my experience, but like, where are you at with it? That's a really good thing to do, because it puts words to some things that they might be experiencing and feeling, but it doesn't map it onto them.
Yeah.
You know, it lets them say, yeah, but no.
Yeah.
You know, it allows them to accept it or push it back and edit it even. And so it's respectful. You know, it comes in with some information and some possible connection, but it doesn't assume that that's exactly how, you know, it's not the same.
It's very easy to put burdens on people who are grieving.
Yes.
Which is the last thing you want to do.
Right.
And most people don't mean to do that.
And we always want to be helpful. I mean, we never move towards somebody. I mean, sometimes we do, wanting to share our story, and there's some pressure with that. But even that is, we want to share it to be helpful, you know, or because we think we connect with them on it. Like, our hearts, the motivation underneath it usually is an attempt to be good. You know, or to comfort, or to be loving, or to connect with somebody. And so, you know, yeah, but how we do it sometimes can really be hurtful, or without us realizing it, it can burden the person grieving. I like the way you said that.
Yeah, it's it is something that as we look at whether, I mean, we're all going to go through that process, and we're surrounded by people, other people that are going to go through that process. So it is something I think that we need to think about and approach with caution and care and prayer, for sure.
I'm going to read a little bit out of the book. It's the story of Grandy, and we've talked about this book yesterday, but it's Tear Soup, and it's written by Pat Schweibert and Chuck Declan, I think, is how you say it. But it is this precious book about the grieving process, and it's like a kid's story, but it's honestly, anybody who reads it just loves it. But it's the story of Grandy and her process of grieving and the things that she comes across. And there's this picture of these people that are kind of in line visiting her, and they've brought her things. And so she's talking about her neighbors, Mrs. Bloomsclot and Mr. Chadwick and Mr. Long, all brave yet fearful neighbors, dropped by to see how Grandy was doing. They filled the air with words, but none of their words took the smell of tear soup away. Grandy was gracious because she knew how helpless her friends felt. They wanted to fix her, but they couldn't. All Grandy really needed from them at that moment was a knowing look and a warm hug. You know, and so you kind of feel it, don't you? You feel these well-wishers or these people that are longing to be supportive, but they don't really know how to kind of come in. And then in one page, she gets a phone call from somebody, and they're Miss Cries a Lot called and reminded Grandy that she's been making tear soup for years now and would be more than glad to come over and show her how to make it right correctly. You know, and so there's all kinds of people that come at you when you're grieving. And so I think it's very important to pay attention to your motivations when you're approaching somebody who's grieving, and to try to surrender any agenda that you might be bringing to the table.
And it's okay if you're in the process of grieving to put boundaries up. Say no and say thank
you. Say not yet.
Thank you, but I can't right now, or that's not what however you, I mean, don't even worry about how you say it, but don't feel bad about saying it.
You know,
or have
someone else say it for you.
Yeah.
And there's one thing I've loved lately. I've seen there's this little card that you can hand out to, like, if your brain is kind of fuzzy at the counter, the cashier or whatever, there's this little card that says, "Be patient with me, I'm grieving." That is being given out by some of the funeral homes that, and I just think that's an absolutely precious idea.
Yeah.
Because it can communicate it without you having to put words to it.
To have to go through the whole story over and over again is very difficult. So, yeah.
Yeah.
Great idea.
Yeah. So you've found a place to belong here in the circle of friends, a safe place, hopefully, for those who are grieving and those who long to support. We are the body of Christ. That's our heart, is to support and love one another. So you've found a place to belong here, and we'll see you tomorrow.
Thanks to generous donations, this program is produced by Circle of Friends Ministries. You can write to us at P.O. Box 345, Berlin, Ohio 44610, or contact us at 330-852-0000. You've found a place to belong.